Hello again, Bea here, and welcome back to biology. Well, this is a bit unusual, but I'm standing outside of a crime scene. I'm a little spooked, but I did hear the authorities saying that the suspect left behind some DNA evidence, so they're hoping they can catch whoever did it. Whew. Do you watch any crime shows on TV? If so, you may think you have a good idea of how DNA is used to solve crimes and pinpoint suspects. Now that you've learned a bit about DNA in biology class, we can look at some of these strategies in detail. We now have all sorts of technology that lets us analyze DNA and decide if the DNA left at the scene of a crime matches a particular suspect's DNA. Of course, just proving the suspect was there doesn't necessarily prove they committed the crime, but it can be pretty significant evidence. We'll check back on the case a little later in the lesson and see if we have any results from the DNA analysis. Until then, we'll look at some of the technologies that investigators will be using. Many of the scientists that work on cases such as these are known as forensic scientists. Forensics is broadly defined as the use of science in a legal setting, but is most often used specifically to indicate that science is being used to help identify a suspect in a crime. After today's lesson, you'll be able to describe how PCR can be used to copy DNA, describe how gel electrophoresis can be used to separate DNA, identify genetic matches using DNA fingerprinting, and explain examples of DNA technology benefiting human health. Assuming the investigators are able to collect some DNA from the crime scene, they will want to see if it matches the DNA of any known suspects. The easiest way to do that is with a technology known as DNA fingerprinting. It's a lot like the kind of fingerprints you may be more familiar with, in that a person's DNA fingerprint is unique to them. So if we find a match, we can be pretty certain that the suspect was at the crime scene. But what is DNA fingerprinting? To answer that, we'll need to back up for a few minutes and talk about a few other technologies that are used in DNA fingerprinting. One of the most important tools of molecular genetics is polymerase chain reaction. You might be more familiar with its common acronym, PCR, which has become a household term to designate a certain type of test for viruses, such as the coronavirus, influenza, and many others. PCR can best be thought of as a copy machine. If it detects a specific strand of DNA, it will make thousands or even millions of copies of that DNA strand so that there is enough DNA present to be detected by a simple test. This is why it's so useful at helping us test for pathogens, such as viruses. As long as we know a specific strand of DNA that exists in the virus, we can set up a PCR to replicate that strand over and over, such that its presence can easily be detected, and a positive result given if the viral DNA is there. But why would we need PCR in our crime scene investigation? Well, if we want to be able to compare the DNA found there with several suspects, we're going to need a lot of DNA to work with. Often, the amount of DNA collected is very small, and we need to make many, many copies in order to make use of it. So, PCR to the rescue! Let's look at how the process works. We start with a double-stranded DNA template. The denaturation step involves heating the DNA so that it separates into two single strands. The annealing step attaches a primer to indicate the place where we want DNA replication to begin. During the extension step, free nucleotides pair with their complementary bases, A's with T's and G's with C's, to build the missing half of the DNA strand. It's basically just like DNA replication that happens in your cells, except that we may only be replicating a small fragment of DNA. At the end of one cycle, we have two strands of the DNA we want, instead of just one. The great thing about PCR is that one cycle happens very quickly, in as little as 1 minute. This means that within a couple of hours, we could potentially have millions or even billions of copies of our desired DNA segment. Because remember that each new strand copied will go on to make 2 more strands, and each of those will make 2 more strands. So the numbers increase exponentially. Using PCR, the investigators of this crime can make as many copies as they need of the DNA that is found. So hopefully they can narrow down a list of suspects quickly. So, our forensics team now has lots of copies of the DNA to work with, thanks to PCR, but how will they analyze it? A common technique is gel electrophoresis. This allows us to separate DNA strands based on length and obtain a visual image of what combinations of strands an individual person has. As the name would suggest, it takes place in a gel substance. The DNA sample is dyed so that it is visible and then loaded into one end of the gel. An electric charge is passed through, which causes the DNA fragments to begin moving across the gel medium. The DNA fragments are negatively charged, so they are naturally attracted to the positive end of the gel. We can think of this like a race. Any guesses who's going to win? If you've ever been stuck in traffic and then seen a motorcycle coming up behind, slipping past you while weaving through stopped cars, then you have some idea what is going to happen here. The gel is thick, like traffic. Large DNA fragments are like large trucks. They aren't going anywhere fast through this sticky surface. Smaller fragments, however, can work their way through much more easily, just like the motorcycle, and end up closer to the end of the plate. Most of your samples will contain many fragments of DNA, so the actual results may look something like this, with each well making a unique pattern of bands based on the sizes of DNA that were present. This process is going to form the backbone of our DNA analysis once we have copies from both the crime scene and our suspects. Because if your DNA was run through gel electrophoresis like this, it would produce a unique pattern, kind of like a fingerprint. So if your pattern matches the pattern from the DNA found at the crime scene, well, you better hope you have a good lawyer. So that brings us back to DNA fingerprinting, which we said earlier was how investigators would determine whether any of the suspects were at the crime scene and left behind a little DNA evidence. The process itself is composed of the two technologies that we just learned about. PCR is used to make lots of copies, both of the DNA of any possible suspects and of any DNA found at the crime scene. Gel electrophoresis is then used to compare the copies of DNA. Well, the results are in. Let's see if we have enough evidence to make an arrest. The DNA found at the crime scene was loaded into the well on the far right. Several possible suspects' DNA were tested in the other wells. Pause the video for a moment here if you need to. Do you see a match? Remember that to hold up in court, it's going to have to be exact. Any guilty parties here? It looks like we do have a match. Suspect number 2's DNA fingerprint is identical to the DNA found at the crime scene. Whew, well, I'm glad this ordeal is over. With the DNA evidence in, hopefully the criminal will be brought to justice. But did you know that DNA fingerprinting can do more than just identify suspects at a crime scene? It's often used to determine familial relationships and can determine if you have inherited certain mutated genes that might lead to disease. An interesting fact to note here is that most human DNA is identical to every other human. In fact, you share about 99.9% of your DNA with every single other person on this planet. So, how can we possibly tell the difference between two people using DNA? Well, it turns out that when you have as much DNA as we do, the 0.1% that is different corresponds to about 3 million unique base pairs, and those can be used to identify us. Scientists have identified many short segments of 40 to 50 base pairs that have a high rate of variation among individuals. These segments are the ones used in DNA fingerprinting. Now that our crime is solved, let's look at some other ways that DNA technology is helping people. One of the most important breakthroughs in genetics has been the sequencing of the human genome. DNA sequencing is exactly what it sounds like it would be, determining the order of nucleotide bases in a DNA molecule. This could involve only a short strand of DNA, or in some cases, the entire genome of a species. The human genome was first sequenced in 2003, but it still had some gaps at that time. A more complete sequencing was completed in March of 2022. This technology allows us to identify the genes that cause inherited diseases and can help us track disease outbreaks, such as the COVID-19 pandemic. Remember that we said in our lesson on viruses that they tend to mutate and evolve. So being able to track and sequence the entire genome of a virus that is spreading helps us see exactly how and where the mutations are occurring. Another DNA technology you may be familiar with is cloning. Ever heard of Dolly the sheep? She was the first mammal successfully cloned from an adult. Fully formed somatic cells were taken from an adult female sheep, labeled A in the diagram. And the DNA from these cells was placed inside an empty egg cell taken from sheep B. This egg cell was then grown in the womb of sheep C. The sheep that was born was an exact genetic copy of sheep A, which donated the original cells. Unfortunately, though the cloning process was successful, Dolly did not live as long a life as we would have expected. It was noticed that her telomeres were shorter than average for her age, and we know that telomeres disappearing can cause aging. Scientists now think that her premature aging due to telomere loss may have been the result of the exact method that was used for the cloning, and are hopeful that this problem can be avoided when we clone animals in the future. But most cloning that goes on in research labs is far less dramatic than cloning an entire organism like Dolly. Cloning is typically used to clone a single gene or a small number of genes together. Why would we bother cloning a single gene? Well, what if that gene just so happened to produce a life-saving protein like insulin? Being able to take insulin injections is necessary for many people living with diabetes. But even healthy people can't donate insulin. We need all of the insulin our bodies produce for ourselves. So to make extra insulin for those who need it, scientists used DNA sequencing to figure out which gene in our body produces it, and used cloning to make more artificial copies of that gene. The insulin gene is actually placed inside the plasmid of a bacteria cell. So the bacteria begins producing insulin for us, which we can then collect. But bacteria cells are small. One bacteria will never produce enough insulin to help us out. You may remember, though, what bacteria are also very good at doing: dividing and multiplying. And every time the bacteria undergoes mitosis, the insulin-producing DNA gets copied right along with it. So we make an entire army of insulin-producing bacteria. And there are many other genes that are cloned and used in similar ways. It is even thought that in the future, we will be able to use cloning to grow entire sections of healthy tissue that could be used to replace sick or injured tissue in patients. And why stop there? We could potentially grow whole new organs for transplant with cloning technology. Finding ways to manipulate natural processes like DNA replication may hold the key to longer and healthier lives. One last type of DNA technology that we should mention is gene therapy. We know that many diseases are caused by genetic mutations. Modern medicine has already come up with many ways to treat and mitigate the symptoms of these diseases, but it would be so much better if we could simply change a person's DNA so that their cells no longer had the mutation. That's the goal of gene therapy, correcting the genetic problem instead of using medication to alleviate the symptoms. This is often done with a genome editing tool called CRISPR. It introduces molecular tools into the cells, which can actually change the DNA. It can be used to turn on genes to help fight disease, or turn off genes that are not functioning properly. Right now, it is commonly being used to treat spinal muscular atrophy, which is a disease that destroys motor neurons, leading to the loss of ability to walk, speak, and breathe. Infants born with the most severe form of the disease often only live for a few years, and even those who live longer are significantly impaired. However, CRISPR technology is able to provide a working copy of the human SMN gene, which helps the motor neurons work properly. And with early diagnosis and treatment, doctors are seeing significant improvement in life expectancy and health. Advancements like these will be the new frontier of biomedical science. As we went through the lesson today, we saw many examples of DNA technology, such as PCR, gel electrophoresis, DNA fingerprinting, DNA sequencing, cloning, and gene therapy. We looked at ways these technologies can be used to solve crimes, but also to help humans live longer, healthier lives. This brings us to the end of our unit on molecular genetics. Next time, you'll have a chance to review everything you've learned here, and then show what you know in the unit assessment. Until then, remember that biology isn't just science, it's the way of life. Hey, hey. See you next time.